Have you ever seen anything so full of splendor?
I have no idea what's going on, but I am excited.
That looks awesome.
You know what a great movie this is. It is so, so much fun. Such a great movie. You'll see it on a big screen and have Martin Landau and Amy Marie Saint to be here. I think what a rare treat that is. As you may know, because I have talked about this on TCM before, the original idea, the way this all came about, Alfred Hitchcock signed with MGM to do a movie called The Wreck of the Mary Dear. And he never could quite get into the enthusiasm about the movie once he has agreed to do it. And he was to work on the script with Ernest Lehman, and it never got really cooking. But he had always wanted to do a movie in which there was a chase around Mount Rushmore. And he also had the title for it, and it was The Man in Lincoln's Nose. And so they thought, they were kicking that around, and they thought, well, let's develop something in which that could be incorporated, and they came up with the idea. And because it was Alfred Hitchcock, and because he was enthused about it, MGM said, well, yeah, go ahead with that. We'll give The Wreck of the Mary Dear to somebody else. And it was later done by Michael Anderson, I think, directed it with Gary Cooper and Charlton Heston. And not that great a story. But they wouldn't let him use that title, The Man in Lincoln's Nose. They thought that was going a bit far. So that's when he came up with North by Northwest, which of course means nothing. Has no connection to the movie whatsoever. And it was originally actually developed for Jimmy Stewart. But then the more it was developed, Hitchcock thought that it really fit Cary Grant much better as a vehicle, and Cary Grant was eager to do it. And I think Jimmy Stewart was not too happy about that for quite some time afterwards, because he always loved working with Hitchcock. But anyway, it is one of the great Hitchcock films, and it's one of those movies that I always tell people, never try to start watching this and think you're going to ever leave it, because once you get into it, you really go. It's got a definitive cast. Amy Marie Saint, never more glamorous in a movie, and she's absolutely terrific in it. This was absolutely... that long after On the Waterfront and her winning the Academy Award for that. And it's early Martin Landau, when we hadn't seen him much before, indeed. Future Academy Award winner. And of course, the great James Mason is in it, Jesse Royce Landis. And I love the fact that just a couple of years before, Jesse Royce Landis had played Grace Kelly's mother in To Catch a Thief. Now she's playing Cary Grant's mother, and she was just, I believe, 8 years older than he was, which made a very young pregnancy for her. But anyway, without any more ado, and before you see this wonderful movie again, it's great pleasure to introduce Amy Marie Saint and Martin Landau. Thank you very much. You're rock stars. You are rock stars.
Oh, you took my. That's what I was going to say. I think Robert.
Sorry.
No, Robert Osborne is our new rock star. And I've been married to the same man for 58 years now, and he is too in love with Robert Osborne.
Thank you. I want to find out first. I mean, just start at the beginning. There are a lot of things I want to ask you, but how you each got involved with Hitchcock on this film, how you first either got connected to him or how he found you or why he thought of you.
Oh, I don't know, Martin, but ladies go first, right, Martin? Okay.
Ladies,
it's
ladies.
Quite an echo in here, isn't it? But you can hear.
Are you getting an echo?
And you hear.
Lady who? No, I love to echo. I mean, whatever that is. Yodel.
Yodel.
Right. Through my agent, I had an invitation to go to Hitch's house for dinner, for lunch. And he was living in Bel Air, so I went, and his dear wife, Alma, was there. and that was the first time I met him. I hadn't read the script, so it was one of those luncheons, and my dear mother, who lived in Westchester, Pennsylvania, she said, honey, I read somewhere, but she didn't read those movie magazines, but she said, I did read somewhere that he likes women in beige and white gloves. Sounds crazy, but I had a package, a little box of white gloves that I wore when I was in New York City in the 50s. The women wore white gloves. And I lived in beige, so I was all set. And I had lunch and I got the part.
Simple as that. Well, it was actually quite a stretch for you because nobody had really seen you in a part like that before.
No, and I know, to this moment, I don't know where he saw me as the sexy spy lady, because I had done On the Waterfront. I wasn't exactly sexy there. Well, in her own way, she was. But I had done That Certain Feeling with Bob Hope, and I wore beautiful clothes, Edith Head clothes. So maybe he thought, you know, maybe he had some kind of image. I never asked him.
But it was great chemical casting in there. A great idea, I think.
Yeah, well, who doesn't want to play a sexy spy lady? I mean, it was just the best.
And Marty, how did you get involved with it?
Well, I was in a play on Broadway called Middle of the Night, which is Patty Jaffe's first play on Broadway. And I toured with it. Edward G. Robinson was a star, and Jenna Rollins played my wife in that play. And we played the Biltmore Theater, which is now gone. Most of the theaters are either insurance companies and parking lots these days that I played in. Hitchcock came opening night to see Edward G. Robinson. And next thing I know, I got a call saying that Mr. Hitchcock would like to meet me at MGM. And I went there, and he greeted me as a long-lost friend and showed me, I went through the offices, and he showed me the entire movie on storyboards. And then said, "You're now Leonard."
And you didn't have to wear white gloves, right?
I didn't wear white gloves nor black gloves.
Were you in beige?
He did take me to Cary Grant's tailor, unbeknownst to Cary, and had a fellow called Contino on Wilshire Boulevard make suits according to Cary's specifications. And I didn't meet Cary Grant until I went to Chicago and on the South Street Station. Hitchcock said, called me and said, "Martin, I'd like to see you in the suit in the location." So I went there. And I was standing with a bunch of extras, minding, you know, watching them shoot before I made my entrance into the inner sanctum. And a fellow came up to me and said, "Excuse me, my name is Ray Austin. Where'd you get that suit?" I swear to God. I said, "Well, why?" He said, "Well, there are only two tailors in the world make a suit like that. Mr. Grant would like to know. One's in Hong Kong and one's in Beverly Hills." And I said, "I think you better have this conversation with Mr. Hitchcock."
You know what's interesting, Martin? So he saw you in Middle of the Night, and I did Middle of the Night on television live.
With E.G. Marshall, I know.
With E.G. Marshall. I love that story.
I saw that.
And it was about a young woman who falls in love with an older man. And in the days of live television, there weren't many stations and channels. And so people really watched the live.
I think Stephen Hill played the role that I played.
Well, that's right. It's amazing. And
all roads lead to Hollywood.
So the two of you didn't know each other in New York?
Well, I knew Jeffrey. I know her husband. Uh-huh. Because in live television, Jeff was one of the busiest directors in live television. Mm-hmm. And recently directed Mark Rydell and myself in Sunshine Boys. And he's a terrific director.
Yes, he is indeed. Yes.
I'll tell him. But when I did Middle of the Night, it's about the older man, the younger girl. So I did a lot of walking. I lived in the village. And so I walked. I was walking that day after the show. And four young women came up to me and said, "I'm going with an older man. Do you think it'll work out?" I said, "I have no idea what you're talking about." But in live television, people got so involved because it was live.
Right.
There was just something magical about it.
Yeah. And it entered our homes and we watched it.
Yeah. And it was live because terrible things happen on the set. And I've never been afraid of anything. Maybe you know, the freeways in LA. I don't know. But I've never been afraid. It was the bloodbath to do live television, but exciting. It was like doing stage.
Did you like the experience?
I love the experience because he cared so much about his leading ladies, as we all know, this wonderful actresses who played in his movies. But he was so concerned about everything, what they wore, their hair. And I love that because that helped me visualize, at least externally, that this lady. And Jeff Martin, I go to the actor studio, so you have to fill in from within yourself. But it really helped. And he only gave me three things as a director. He said, lower your voice, don't use your hands, and look directly into Cary Grant's eyes at all time.
Was that tough?
A rock star, not bad.
Was that tough looking into Cary Grant's eyes?
No, that wasn't tough at all. Not using my hands was the hardest thing, as you notice. But I'm not going to use them anymore today.
Okay. Economy.
Check me if I do. Yeah.
Well, you know, I was fresh from the theater, where you work a lot with the directors, and he rarely told me anything. So, in fact, during the auction gallery scene, he had said something to you, something to Cary, and something to James, and passed me by. And I felt a little left out, so I said, is there anything you want to tell me, Mr. Hitchcock? And he said, Martin, I'll only tell you if I don't like what you're doing. Not to say that he didn't like what she was doing.
I was going to say. You're going to tell that story again, ever?
That'll cost you $10.
So it was a good experience for you as an actor.
It was a terrific experience. I mean, you know, as Eva just said, we came from different worlds. I mean, we came from Lee Strasberg, the actor studio, and Eva's film with Marlon Brando on the waterfront. I mean, it was like, when you think about her in that role and think about her in this role in this film, I mean, it's 180 degrees. You really should pay attention to the kind of range that this young lady has.
Well, absolutely. Go along with that.
He saw me in the play in which I played a very macho musician. It was all over the stage, actually. I mean, he was egocentric and kind of foolish. As Eva said, Jenna Rowland's character falls in love with this older man, and my character comes back from Las Vegas, where he's been playing a musical gig, and figures he just puts his hands on his wife, and she'll, you know, forget about the older man, and of course she rejects him. So I play this jerk, and the character in North by Northwest, which I chose to play as a gay character, wasn't quite written that way, because he wanted to get rid of Eva's character with such a vengeance. I thought, as opposed to just being a henchman, it would be an interesting choice. And he let me do that. It was very subtle, but...
That's interesting. I was going to ask you where that came from, if that was Hitchcock or if that was you, that element in there.
Well, Ernie Lehman actually added a line which wasn't in the original script when he saw the dailies, which is, there's a scene where I reveal that the gun didn't have real bullets in it that Eva shoots Cary Grant with.
Why'd you have to tell him that?
I'm sorry.
Oh, you're going to see the film, right?
You know, you're in for a treat, because most of the people that I've talked to in the last bunch of years have seen this movie on little screens, and it deserves to be seen on a screen of this.
Yeah, it's quite a different movie, isn't it?
Getting back to the... Ernie added a line which was kind of daring in the 1950s, which was, call it my woman's intuition, if you will. My character says that to James Mason. And which I felt was a pretty audacious line in its day.
That was interesting. You hearing that line, and to really justify that gave you that whole wonderful character.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, one thing about Hitchcock, he always did hire the best actors. So he obviously expected them to bring something or most of it, to the table. But did he ever talk to you about interpretation or
no,
the character?
No, it's interesting. He never, I don't know about Martin, but he never, the opposite of a Kazan who directed On the Waterfront.
Right.
But he didn't do it that way. That was really up to you. But you had a sense on the set that he saw something in you for that character, even if you didn't see it yourself. When I first read the script, I just had a baby, and I said, I don't know, I don't come in until page 70. And my, isn't that awful? And my husband, don't tell those other people out there. But my husband, who's a director, he said, honey, I think you just ought to read this again. And I actually thought in the back of my mind, how am I going to climb Mount Rushmore at this point in my life? But they say exercise after you have a baby, and that's what I did. I climbed the... But you'll notice in the movie, when I go like this, I run my elbow. I fall. I'm supposed to slide on Mount Rushmore, and the young man who was supposed to catch me off screen was looking the other way, and I just kept sliding and sliding. And I thought, as the character, my elbow hurts, and I'm going to rub it. And it's in this story, in the screen, on the screen.
Yeah, you both worked with so many wonderful directors. And as a matter of fact, with Woody Allen and Crimes and Misdemeanors.
Woody doesn't direct at all.
That you're going to be doing. But how would you rank Hitchcock among all those wonderful directors you worked with? Was he one of the best? Was he most unusual? Most.
Well, he was very clear as to what the visual thing was. Uh-huh. But I agree. I think he just leaves you alone. If he casts you, he trusts you. Uh-huh. And I was a new kid on the block, so I was really an unknown. I mean, he saw me in a play and playing character, as I say, completely different. You know what Carrie's going to do, pretty much. You know what James is going to do. He didn't really know what I was going to do, and he welcomed it and was very generous.
Did you know what I was going to do?
I had no idea what.
Right.
As a matter of fact,
I surprised you.
It's still one of the sexiest performances extant.
Yeah. How about that?
Oh, I really mean that. I mean that scene in the dining car is probably one of the most.
So, I look at that though, Mark, and I'm so against smoking. I've never smoked, and if any of you are still smoking, really think about it, giving it up. I'm not going to lecture, but really think about it, seriously. But so I look at that scene, and I don't smoke through the whole movie though. That's good. Just for that. Now you'll notice in that scene. How does that work when I say, he's being very suggestive, and I say, I never make love on an empty stomach. Now, that's what I said, but I had to loop make love to, I never make love on an empty stomach. I never discuss love on an empty stomach, instead of I never make love. So you'll notice the dubbing. It's not easy to discuss.
No, because you see her mouth say, make love, and you say, discuss love. That's coming out of her mouth.
Now, don't let that distract you. I want you to enjoy the movie.
No, but we do have to talk about, for those that haven't seen it, or aren't aware of this, that other wonderful moment with the gun, because that doesn't give any plot away.
That doesn't what?
Oh, doesn't give the plot away.
You mean the little boy?
Yes.
Oh.
But because that's so fascinating to watch for.
Okay, but again, don't let it distract you. But
no, because we won't give the plot away. It's just there's this. I'll set it up and then you take it from there.
Whatever Robert Osborne said, I'll do.
No. There's a scene in which there is some action going on and somebody gets shot. Well, watch in a scene that takes place in the cafeteria.
In the cafeteria of Mount Rushmore.
Of Mount Rushmore. When there's some action there, look at a table way in the back, and there are people sitting there eating. They're kind of picnic table kind of thing. And all of a sudden, you'll see a little boy go. Now, they obviously had rehearsed the scene, and he knew there was a gunshot coming. So he was prepared for when it came when they shot the scene. It's wonderful if you haven't seen it, but it happened so far up in the corner, and of course, in those days, 1959, mm-hmm. when a film came out, it was usually seen once, and then nobody saw a film again. So I'm sure if they did notice it, they thought, well, it's not worth going back and having to shoot again.
Yes, it's very curious because it was a little boy, and I was having trouble with a gun. It's very difficult to shoot a gun if you've never shot a gun. Even if it's make-believe, I'm Quaker, maybe that's it.
That could be it.
You never know. I discovered that right this minute. But I never noticed what some fan noticed, which was the little boy going like that. And he pointed it out, so then I watched the movie, and I saw that. And as we sit here, I don't know whether it was Hitch saying, aha, here we are talking about it, or as Robert thinks and my husband thinks that, you know, he saw it and why go back and just do it over again. It's such a dramatic scene, maybe no one will notice. Well, every one of you is going to notice.
As a matter of fact, I'm doing a Q&A on Sunday, and if you will notice in one little spot during Cleopatra, there is a bit of a jet stream.
Oh my God.
In ancient Rome.
And that probably had a lot. And they probably had a lot of extras, right? They couldn't go
15,000 extras. 50, so
you can't pull them all back to reshoot. Yes, exactly. Well, it's so wonderful having you here and sharing these memories with us. And thanks for being
Robert.
Here, as always. Thank you. Thank you for adding.